I'm not sure. They're waiting for it.
Nearly 40 years after the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombings, Alaskans are involved in the continuing controversy surrounding nuclear weapons and their use.
It's time to start considering other ways to go about guaranteeing national security than simply building more weapons and trying to have an even larger standoff with the Soviet Union.
America needs to deal from a position of strength, and if we're perceived to be weak and not really prepared to protect ourselves, we're going to find times getting tough in terms of dealing with other countries, and particularly the Soviet Union.
Alaska, strategically, is a very important part of the overall defense of the North American continent.
Americans would most likely take a more active role in civil defense needs if the country had come under attack of the type in Europe.
You don't talk to anyone who has any desire to see a nuclear war happen. It's simply a matter of what we do to prevent it. And there are those on one side that say that the only way we can prevent it is by building more weapons and being so strong that we can intimidate whoever the opposition is into not contemplating using their weapons. And then there's other people, and I'm among them, who think that we have more than enough weapons to provide a deterrent to anyone who would contemplate using those weapons on us.
This country is placing itself in a position of great danger by not attempting to maintain its strength in the eyes of the world, so that when we get into those confrontations that we're in a position to deal effectively. And it doesn't mean that we've got to blow a bomb or we've got to actually go to some kind of confrontation, but the fact that if we believe we could not succeed in some military confrontation, I think then we would in fact be giving up. And that's what I think the ultimate step would be in this particular issue.
The issue is the future of nuclear weapons in America. The forum is a grassroots movement which is called on voters throughout the country by means of advisory, community, and state ballots.
The Freeze movement got its big start in April of 1980 when the call to halt the nuclear arms race was put out, and it proposed what has become the hallmark of all of the true freeze resolutions. That is a mutual freeze on testing, production, and deployment of nuclear weapons and their delivery systems, such as missiles, aircraft, submarines, that kind of a thing. In Alaska, the residents of Fairbanks, Anchorage, and Juneau voted on the freeze, our three largest cities, and Juneau and Anchorage passed it narrowly, but it was nonetheless passed. The people in Fairbanks didn't pass it.
The vote is tallied, but debate over the freeze movement continues. Assemblyman Don Smith opposed the freeze proposition when it was introduced to the Anchorage Assembly and campaigned against it in the election.
If a system is developed where they can, in effect, stop our ability to defend ourselves, you know, then we're going to have to give up. Some people say it's already happened.
People who make that charge that the Freeze Movement is trying to weaken the United States are coming from a radically different set of assumptions about what national security means.
If you're perceived to be the weaker of the two, they'll force the point where you'd end up having to give up because you were not strong enough.
Over and over again, you keep coming back to what is your view of the Soviet Union, and from that come all the assumptions that would lead you in down one direction or another in this whole national defense area. My reading of the situation is that, in fact, the Soviet Union has been playing catch-up ever since World War II because they have perceive themselves to be threatened by the United States.
I don't perceive America as being aggressive. I think that we're a pretty good nation in terms of history. The fact is that millions of Americans are getting caught up in this movement, thinking that it's, you know, it's a very innocent thing. We just want to show that we're opposed to the nuclear weapons buildup. They would just as soon let the Russians, you know, be in charge as to continue this weapons buildup. I can't quite understand how they can think that way.
We're not unilateral disarmers. We're not saying, oh, let's just lay down all of our arms, and if the Russians want to overrun us, then that's okay, because that's better than being destroyed by our own nuclear bombs. We're saying, look, we can think about this rationally, and one of the ways that we can achieve a safer world is to gain agreement that is verifiable, that we can feel relatively confident that we're not going to have a sneak attack pulled on us, and then gradually reduce these weapons and the possibility of the use of these weapons and develop a level of trust.
The nuclear freeze people think that somehow all the rifles will sprout daisies and the world will be a beautiful place, and I just happen to believe the opposite, that we've got to maintain our strength if we want to, you know, protect ourselves.
I have been such a strong supporter of the freeze because it does give you a way out of the morass. It's like you're caught in this dilemma, you know. Well, gosh, we've got to be secure. We can't let the Russians walk over us, and on the other hand, we're getting more and more insecure by building more bombs. This way, we can work through it, and, you know, with adequate support and representation from our congressional delegation and from the President and his cabinet, I think we can do a good job.
Hundreds of communities in several states have passed freeze directives. Fairbanks was among the handful of communities in single state that rejected the freeze. Cindy Marquette, campaign coordinator of Alaskans for the Prevention of Nuclear War, talks about some of the reasons the group believes the proposition failed.
But it was basically a conservative ballot, and there was two bar issues on the ballot, and it brought a lot of people out from areas where we didn't campaign heavily, and those people voted a no ticket. They voted no on all the propositions, and I think that they really didn't understand what the freeze was, and they saw it and they just checked the little no box because they were voting no on one and two, which is the bar propositions, and they went right down and voted no all the way down.
What we should have done, rather than concentrate solely on communities and areas where we thought the vote might be favorable and try to get as many of those people to vote as possible, we should have gone to the areas where the people might be, and did in fact vote unfavorably, because I think those are the areas where the people have not been exposed enough to the facts on this issue to understand what it's about. And I think that they probably did not even know what the freeze meant.
Nuclear discussion groups are forming in other parts of the state, and the freeze groups in Juneau, Anchorage, and Fairbanks plan to continue public education programs.
There should be something going on locally that would inform people about what was going on with nuclear weapons and the nuclear arms race, and that would also get them thinking about those issues and get them to start taking a part in the political decisions which form the basis for the arms race.
I I feel that Alaska would be one of the prime targets as far as nuclear war.
Probably be less affected than other places, but still that's not saying very much.
Only because we have the military bases, I feel that we might be involved inadvertently. I don't know if this would be the means stopping or a deterrent from any other country, but we are so close to military base here, we could be affected.
Alaska, strategically, is a very important part of the overall defense of the North American continent. Because of the location of the state, we are very confident that a Soviet bomber attack would have to cross the state of Alaska. And as such, our mission is to destroy those aircraft before they get to the lower 48. Regarding the military installations in the state of Alaska, we have two main operating bases for the Air Force, Elmendorf Air Force Base, which is headquarters for the Alaskan Air Command, the Alaska NORAD region, and the 21st TAC Fighter Wing. In the interior, we have Eielson Air Force Base, which is headquarters for the 343rd Composite Wing and the 6th Strat Wing. We have two forward operating bases that are used for forward deployment of our air defense forces, King Salmon and Galena Air Force Base. And then in the further tip of the Aleutians, we have Shimea Air Force Base.
260-233,
the Navy has, of course, an installation at ADAC in the Aleutians, Kodiak with the Coast Guard. We have three Army installations, Fort Richardson. We have Fort Wainwright and Fort Greeley. And, of course, our 13 radar sites located the interior and along the coastal part of the state, and then 6 dew line sites along the north coast. In addition to strategic defense, we have Clear Air Force Station just outside of Fairbanks. Their purpose is, in conjunction with 2 other radar stations, one at Thule, Greenland, and one in England, to detect Soviet activity, specifically ballistic missiles, that are launched and determine if those missiles are headed for the United States. They also, on day-to-day activity, monitor Soviet satellite activity and provide that information both to NORAD at Colorado Springs as well as Strategic Air Command at Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska. Occasionally, we will have an unknown aircraft that will enter the radar coverage. If unable to correlate the flight plan, then we will scramble aircraft either from Galena or King Salmon to go up and to visually identify that aircraft. And we have identified Soviet aircraft both to the, in the northwest part of Alaska as well as the west central and the southwest part of the state. I might add that no aircraft, to my knowledge, have ever overflown the landmass itself. It's just the airspace surrounding the state of Alaska.
But is Alaska considered a potential target in the event of a nuclear attack?
It is speculation, and we certainly feel that military targets are a likely candidate. We also feel that many of the civilian areas of population, center of government, Juneau, for example, is a very logical choice for some sort of nuclear attack or nuclear detonation.
I am not aware of any civil defense programs myself, because I believe if there is a nuclear war that it's going to be total destruction, and therefore I'm very pessimistic about it, and I don't feel that civil defense would do any good.
I think we should have a better civil defense program. I think it should be funded by the United States government.
A nuclear war would make that area eligible for a national disaster, like a flood or earthquake.
If a nuclear disaster occurs, the Division of Emergency Services is responsible for organizing state government actions. The division is now in the process of updating the state civil defense plan, which prepares for a nuclear attack. Jack Cervantes, South Central District Supervisor, describes the state's plan and Anchorage preparedness.
Basically, it's a guideline for state government actions, including continuity of government, what departments within state have certain emergency tasking. The plan that we're working under right now makes one assumption based on the nuclear attack. It's a primarily with limited warning or tactical warning, and as a consequence, not having certain actions available to us because of time constraints, we would shelter people basically in place. Our revision program is doing two things. We have an improvement grants planner, which basically we use federal funds to update our emergency plan as it exists today. We have a separate planner on board, a nuclear civil protection planner, which incorporates a new modus operandi, if you will, that's known as the crisis relocation plan. The options for Alaska would be highly restrictive. In other words, the only community that has been prepared for state actions is Fairbanks. There is a mini crisis relocation plan in existence by the Anchorage Civil Defense Office, which basically accommodates what city government would do.
We're blessed with kind of a school solution type of thing because we have this this big highway that that goes through Anchorage, the Seward Highway. It comes in at the bottom and goes out at the top. And so we ask our planning department people, where would the middle line of the population of Anchorage be, in other words? So, and they told, they give me 36th Street. So we put a dividing line there and we say everybody north of 36th Street will go north and everybody south of 36th Street will go out to the south. And down the road we had to put out things like bulldozers, and if somebody broke down and if it interrupted the traffic, they're going to have to be pushed off the road. We have to have a certain number of tankers out there because to refuel people and run out of didn't have a full tank of gas or something. But we would, I mean, it could be done. If we had absolute coordination and control, we could evacuate Anchorage in 12 hours.
We have not exercised the crisis relocation plan as yet. To be sort of facetious about it, you could say we exercise crisis relocation plan if you've ever been on the Glen Highway commuting between the valley and Anchorage.
Although Anchorage has an evacuation system, the state plan to provide food and shelter once residents reach the Matanuska Valley and Kenai Peninsula will not be in place until September of 1983.
It's conceivable that about 20 to 40% of the population may evacuate on its own without any directions whatsoever. Some of these people would probably return to the lower 48 where they had loved ones or family. Some others might relocate to summer cottages or cabins, hunting areas, more remote areas away from the Anchorage area that they owned land at. Some may just go without any preparations at all except for what they could take. But for that remaining balance of population and of Anchorage, it would be basically at this point in time, and that's speaking right now, it would be catch-as-catch-can. There's no shelters to accommodate them, no food distribution programs or anything else.
Emergency plans exist because of the destructive effect a 1 megaton surface burst would have on its target. If Elmendorf Air Force Base in Anchorage was hit,
you'd have heavy destruction in the 1.5 miles. The severe damage is 3 miles. You'd be relatively safe in an underground shelter past this 3 mile area. Anchorage today has over 230,000 fallout shelters and approximately 100,000 spaces for blast shelters. Moderate damage would be 5 miles. The houses would be, the windows would all be blown out, and you'd have some pretty heavy damage to a wood frame house. Concrete buildings wouldn't have very much damage. Light damage is 8 miles. The Diamond Boulevard would be approximately the 8 mile limit, which would be relatively safe past that.
But what are some of the after effects survivors could expect?
And a little bit of pressure has dropped down to about 90.
We will have problems with hospitals because the state's majority of medical services in the Anchorage area are located within this 2.5 mile zone. So we would have to be looking at establishing clinics, other types of shelters within the, say, school system to accommodate people to get them away from this immediate target zone. The burn centers, there's been quite a bit of discussion of what the burn casualty would be. And even for shelter in place, they would be severe and would overtax our medical facilities here in the state. As an example, with a population of 200,000 people in Anchorage around the Elmendorf area, it's conceivable we would have 10,000 burn cases. With the burn units, they usually can accommodate 8 people. You can see the severe tasking that the medical personnel would be under. If we did have a nuclear detonation in Anchorage, with the fallout patterns through Matsu Borough, it would be conceivable we'd have to remain underground here for 7 weeks. With zero resupply at all, and one of the assumptions is, however, that shipping en route to Alaska at the time of a nuclear attack would continue, we would have at the wholesale level probably 2 to 4 weeks supply of dry goods. The fresh vegetables, fresh meats, probably a 1 week supply. And again, this would occur at the retail level. So all told, we continue to resupply the urban areas for about 2 weeks with what was on en route for fresh supplies. The dry goods, we would probably have a 1 month to 6 week supply in Alaska. The bush communities are a little bit different because of their annual resupply mechanism. And so timing would be a very critical situation. If the attack, say, had occurred in November or December of that nature, the bush would probably be in fairly good shape. They could have at least 6 months' supplies of foods. But if it happened towards a late winter or early spring, it's conceivable that the bush communities would be very shorted on the food supplies.
Whether people could survive the long-term effects of a nuclear war is debatable. Philip and Linda Deuce of Homer believe a nuclear war, like other disasters, is survivable if you plan ahead. They have formed a nonprofit organization stressing self-sufficiency and preparedness.
Now, if we are cut off from the lower 48, that is going to leave people, a number of people without homes. It's going to leave a number of people without food who have not prepared by storing it, clothing, medical resources. I don't know how long the resources will last in the Anchorage area, but I know that in the Anchor Point and Homer area, they won't last more than a week. That would put people I don't know how you'd say it. It'd be a real nasty situation to be in, though. And that's one of the things we're trying to teach, is how people could survive in that event. It would be very nice if the government were able to provide protection for its citizenry, but it's not set up that way. They don't have the funding for it right now. And therefore, I think the only way that people would survive in that event would be to prepare themselves and provide their own protection. Preparation seems to be the key to a positive outlook. Again, I don't like to dwell on the gloom and doom part of the nuclear war aspect. And if you're prepared for something, if you know something about it, you don't need to fear it that much.
I think it's very important that people realize that, you know, there's the big question, could you survive a nuclear war? And I think a lot of Alaskans feel as if up here we're kind of isolated and, you know, I can make it, you know, I could survive if I had to, and that kind of attitude towards it. And you know, nobody survives a nuclear war. The kind of nuclear war that they're talking about now isn't the kind of nuclear war that I think any of us ever could possibly picture.
My biggest concern is simply that people think about the issue and not sort of read the newspaper and toss it away and sort of assume that that's the gospel on what national defense is all about because President Reagan said it or because Caspar Weinberger said it. There's lots of sources for information, and I think one needs to be very skeptical.
A lot of people say, well, there'll never be a nuclear war. You know, we don't have to worry about that. That'll never happen. It has happened, and a lot of us have forgotten that. You know, that has happened. Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it has happened. And it can happen again.
There's a number of materials available today. Learn about it. There are so many things you can do, and then tell your neighbors.
As far as our children are concerned, it's going to be with them the rest of their life. And it's going to be with us the rest of our lives.